Good morning, good afternoon. In this session, I'm going to present you results on the linear Weingarten surfaces of isotropic geometry, surfaces that we nicknamed Heini-Wein surfaces to make them a little bit less scary. We'll look at their applications to design funicular shells with planar quadrangles. So this is results from my PhD work on the linear at the Navier Laboratory and on the Lama Laboratory. That's the place where you should be at. This event was not online, but live. So this was a work done by Cyril Dutz, Olivier Barrel, and Laurence Fields. So the focus of the work is on double curvature structures. We know that these structures may be very efficient if they work with membrane action. You may use a very small amount of material. They are a very good way to reduce the environmental impact of the construction industry. Their main limitation is, however, their complexity. They're complex to fabricate, to design, to assemble, and their structural performance is not guaranteed, depends on the shape. So there's a question on how to design a curved structure while accounting both for fabrication and structural efficiency at the same time. So we're going to have a very high altitude review of the different methods that have been used to fulfill these two conditions, fabrication, structural efficiency at the same time, to see where our proposed methods fits in. And we look more precisely at how they take shape and topology into account. So there's the first big family of methods that will take topology as an input, and that will give you resulting shapes based on the results of your optimization. That's the case of hanging nets, dynamic relaxation methods, subdivisions and optimization. All of this, if you change the topology of, that is the connectivity, the pattern that you use to connect your elements, you change the shape you obtain from the process. In a second family of shapes, of methods, shape is an input, and you try to find a pattern or topology such that you fulfill your fabrication properties or structural efficiency. So for example, accounting only for fabrications, wanted for example planar quadrangles, you will align your patterns with conjugate nets on the surface. Now if you want to have at the same time mechanical efficiency and fabrication properties, you get actually problems that are quite constrained. So you'll often need to relax the properties you want for having panels that are not exactly panels or not following exactly the straight lines, the stress lines on your surface. Or you may also relax the proximity of your final shape to the target surface. So there is, for highly constrained problems, we see that the previous two approaches tend to have limitations. And there is a third way, more flexible, that's it is to take a boundary curve as an input and to derive both the shape and the topology pattern that fulfills all the properties you want. So for example, if you want a surface for which the principal curvature lines, the lines that give you a lot of properties to simplify fabrication of a grid shell in particular, surfaces for which these principal curvature lines are funicular for a given load case, that's a typical example for which previous approaches do not work well. And in general, people do a two-step process. In the first step, they will generate a surface with a certain geometrical property that guarantees that in a second step, a remeshing will allow you to obtain the properties. So in the step one, for example, using the middle, you use constant mean curvature surfaces, soap bubbles, to add as a shape to remesh after. So that is in this family, global family of methods, that Heini-Wein surfaces fits. More particularly, they will solve the following problem. Given a target boundary, how can we obtain simultaneously a mesh for which edges are funicular under a uniform vertical load? So we'll consider only uniform vertical loads. That's an assumption based assumption. And such that the panels are planar quadrangles. Very interesting properties for greenhouses, for example, covered with double glazing panels or CLT panels. So the question, what shape and what topology work for this problem, we look at this solution. As shape, we will look at high-level surfaces. And for topology, we will look at the networks of isotropic principal curvatures, I that we nickname I principal curvatures. So the presentation will be in two parts. First, we'll look at these high-level surfaces. What are they? Why do we look at them? In a second step, we'll look at how can we design construct them. So to introduce high-level surfaces, we first need to introduce isotropic geometry, the context from which they emerge. So isotropic geometry is just a way to describe shapes with a specific set of tools in which the vertical directions plays a different role from the other directions. And the difference with the more traditional Euclidean geometry is best seen when looking at curvature, which is the quantity that will be relevant for the work here. In Euclidean geometry, if we look at a planar curve, we define the curvature as the inverse of the radius of the osculating circle, which is also the rate of variation of the angle of a tangent line with a small variation of curvilinear apses. But in isotropic geometry, we'll describe the slope by the derivative of the function. And the curvature will be defined as how this quantity varies for a small increment of the apsis, not the curvilinear length. And this naturally gives us a definition of the curvature as the second derivative. So quite a much more simple definition, something more simple to compute than in Euclidean geometry. Now for a surface, it will be natural to describe the geometry of a surface using height fields for function f, two variables and x and y that give you the height at any point. In this context, we'll describe the curvature using the isotropic curvature tensor that combines all the second derivative, which is just the Hessian matrix of F. And if we diagonalize this matrix, we get principal curvature directions that are different from the ones in Euclidean geometry. But something interesting, if we remesh a surface following these high principal directions, we get near planar quadrangles. So we have construction properties embedded in these nets. And by looking at this, the principle, the max and minimum curvature, here, we get by taking the mean value and the product, the mean and Gaussian curvature from isotropic geometry. So you see there's a little index I to differentiate them from their classical Euclidean curvature. Another object we will look at are high-level surfaces. They're defined by the fact that there is a linear combination of this mean and Gaussian curvature that is constant on the surface. It is the same everywhere. So you might be a bit puzzled looking at this equation that looks rather exotic, but you have actually seen quite a lot of high-level surfaces in your life. All the paraboloids, for example, are surfaces with constant isotropic mean curvature and are thus high-level. It's also a bit more exotic, the Pelican surfaces, surfaces for which the membrane stresses, when projected in the plane, are constant uniform. And here I would like to thank our professor Yves van Satchos for bringing this surface to our attention, because that's really the thing that triggered the work on these surfaces and the results. Now there are another fun family of high-level surfaces that you can obtain from harmonic functions. The idea is you just compute any function of the variable z, the complex variable z. You take the real part of this and interpret this as a height field function of the plane, and you get a great variety of functions of shapes with quite interesting shapes that appear. For example, you have the monkey saddle in the middle by looking at z to the power of 3. Now, for the one property why we look at high-level surfaces is the following one result that we were able to prove. If you apply a uniform vertical load to these surfaces, they will be funicular, and the stress lines will coincide with the high principal curvature lines. So that means that rematching them by the isotropic principal lines, you get at the same time planar quadrangles and funicular edges, so something that is highly relevant for grid shells. So we've seen this surface have nice properties. We've seen quite a few interesting shapes. Can we go beyond these shapes to fit this surface on the target boundary? The answer is yes. And actually to solve this problem, we actually get to quite a famous problem in mathematics and physics called the Monge-Ampère equation. So this Heilevine equation is actually one particular case of this equation, which has many applications ranging from optimal transport, reflector design, proofs in differential geometry. The Fields Medal 2018 was related to the solutions of this equation. So it's quite complex to solve, highly nonlinear. You do not have variational principles. It's hard to prove the existence and unicity on non-convex boundaries, often impossible. There are some generation methods for the general case, but that are quite complex. So we use the fact that we have a simple simple case of this equation to propose a generation method based on a discrete model, based on discrete differential geometry, on triangular meshes, models proposed by Potman and Liu to describe the isotropic mean and Gaussian curvature of a triangular mesh. It's still a non-convex problem, so we have to develop numerical tricks based on differential geometry, something we won't go into in this presentation. You have the details in the paper. But in the end, the solution, this algorithm, ends up is equivalent to having to solve one parabolic equation in X for each node at each iteration. So it's quite fast, and like it will take a minute to get surfaces like the one you see on the right. And on these examples, you see we have taken the boundary of paraboloids, and we show that we can recreate paraboloids with this algorithm with a very good precision. Then the idea is that you can go beyond the paraboloids and explore quite a lot of variety of shapes while keeping the same fabrication and structural properties. So for a designer, the method behaves like this. You take an input boundary curves, the one given by your project constraints. Then you will remesh the surface with a triangular mesh. So there's a lot of plugins available to do it on the internet. And then trying to solve this Heilevine equation, well, we have three parameters. Actually, you can set the first one equal to one, because you see if you multiply all the parameters by two, then you have the same surface. And you are left with two parameters, B and C. And by varying parameter C, what you will control is the average height on the surface. With a low value of C, you will end up with a surface that has low height. And as you increase C, you will increase the average height. Now, parameter B will have a different effect. It will control the height difference between domes and saddle points. You see on the left here, we have quite this marked valleys here, whereas on the right, we varied B such that we have a much more uniform crest line. The difference is more visible on this example. We have this closed eight-like boundary loop, and with a negative B, you see that we have this very marked saddle here, with a high difference between the mountain top and the saddle, whereas with a positive B, we have this much more uniform shape. Once you have this shape, you need to actually remesh them by isotropic principal curvature lines to obtain the properties we're interested in, planar quads, funicular edges. How can you do this? Well, you could just integrate the eigenvectors of your Hessian matrix of the height fields, write your own algorithm. But actually, if you're a bit lazy, there's a trick to use existing algorithms by doing a detour by Euclidean geometry. The trick is to take your Heilevine surface, scale it down vertically quite a bit. In this state, the slope is very small, such that the isotropic and the Euclidean principal curvature nearly coincide with very good precision. So you can compute curvature line networks on this configuration using your favorite algorithm. And then you can scale it back by vertical scaling a surface. The high principal curvature lines do not change direction. They stay exactly the same. So you can use very simply this kind of shapes. An interesting aspect of this method is you can deal with quite complex boundaries for which a quadrimeshing and a shape editing backhand would be quite tedious. So here you can obtain automatically shapes and patterns that fulfill the constraints, and you have 2 degrees of freedom to do so. And you have, have an example of the boundary of the Chadstone grid shell with many variations, and you see that the topology of the mesh, that is a solution, automatically appears, and you have automatic placement of singularities that emerge from the shape. So there are some limitations, of course, to this work, firstly on a structural point of view. To actually get the funicular behavior, of course, you need proper boundary supports of your shell. Your supports must be in particular able to resist horizontal thrust. Also, you need to check other matrices, asymmetric ones, and to consider buckling. So your uneven surface will be most likely a little bit different from the 100% optimized solution. And numerically, for some complex boundaries, there will be actually no existence of a solution if the ratio B over C is too high. You always have a solution if B is equal to zero, but as you increase, if you increase B too much, sometimes you have no solution. So to conclude on these highly fine surfaces, there are one family of solutions to one highly constrained problem for which the other optimization methods usually do not work well. The problem being finding a funicular planar quadrangle mesh fitting a target boundary curve. So combining mechanics and efficiency and an interesting fabrication property of planar quadrangles. The method gives you a way to generate automatically both the shape and the patterns and giving you 2 degrees of freedom to do so. And an interesting aspect is that you tend to have harmonious shapes with this, and in particular, harmonious patterns, because if you look at the high principal curvature lines on an arbitrary surface, well, usually they are not smooth. They do not give you a pattern that is usable as a pattern for your panels, for your grid shell. Whereas here, as you've seen on the examples, it tends to be really smooth. So we think that these surfaces are an interesting tool, in particular for early conceptual design phases. And we've seen that they won't give you a final design because they do not take other node cases into account, for example, but they allow you to explore quickly quite an interesting variety of shapes fitting your boundary. So that, for example, you may assess grid shell options at early project phases. So I thank you for your attention, and I will be glad to take your questions if you have any on April 28th.